Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of A Promise for Ellie by Lauraine Snelling, narrated by Stina Nielsen. This book is copyrighted 2006 by Lauraine Snelling. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. Ellie Wold can't wait to graduate. She and her fiancé, Andrew, have been waiting to get married since, well, since forever. But circumstances are about to put a stop to her plans, and things begin to unravel. Will forces beyond her control put an end to Ellie's dream? And now, A Promise for Ellie.
Prologue. Blessing, North Dakota, May 1900. The clanging church bell woke them all. Andrew Bjorklund and his father Håkon met at the bottom of the stairs, pulling up their suspenders as they shoved their feet into their boots by the back door. Clanging bells in the night always meant fire. Astrid pounded down the stairs, tying her hair back as she came. "Where is it?"
"No idea yet."
Håkon stepped out onto the front porch of their two-story white house and scanned the area for the red flames and billowing smoke.
"Looks like the Olsen's place. Andrew, you get the horses. Astrid, help me get buckets and shovels in the wagon. Andrew can ride on ahead."
He raised his voice.
"You bring the rugs, Ingeborg."
"Yeah, I will,"
she called from the bedroom.
"I'm almost dressed."
"Was there heat lightning?" Andrew asked a few minutes later as they threw harnesses over the horses' backs.
"Could have been. I was sleeping too sound to hear any thunder. Besides, it's clear now."
Håkon finished snapping the traces onto the double tree.
"You take Yak and get on over there."
Within minutes, Astrid and Ingeborg were in the wagon and they started down the lane, Håkon driving the team all out.
"Lord, please protect our friends. Keep everyone safe."
Ingeborg prayed, her eyes open, hanging on for dear life as they took a sharp corner at only a slightly reduced speed. She kept praying the entire way. Håkon pulled the team to a skidding stop, the second wagon to have arrived. Already a bucket brigade had formed, but they were dumping water on the barn roof and soaking the other buildings. The fire roared as it devoured the machine shed, which was too far gone to try to drown the flames.
"What happened?"
Håkon hollered as he climbed a ladder to throw water on the house roof.
"Don't know. Woke to the dog barking."
Ole Olsen handed up a bucket of water and reached for another from below as the lines grew with more wagons and horses arriving by the minute.
"Just got to keep it from spreading."
As the flames died down, the firefighters gathered together.
"Thank God there was no wind."
Ingeborg wiped the sweat off her face with her apron and glugged the cup of water someone handed her. She turned to the woman behind her.
"Any idea what started it?"
"None."
Mrs. Olsen wrung her hands.
"But if it weren't for all of you, the entire place might have gone up. Thank the good Lord for friends."
Reverend Solberg nodded and drank deeply.
"That church bell saved us again. And to think, we almost didn't put one up." "We've talked about the fire wagon. I think it's time to stop talking about it and start doing something about it."
Håkon clapped Andrew on the shoulder.
"You young men did a fine job with the barn roof. That would have gone up next. And if the ground had been drier, a prairie fire may have started." "Lots of maybes and might-haves. Let's pray and thank our God for what is."
Reverend Solberg waited for silence.
"Father in heaven, we offer our heartfelt thanks for your providence, for keeping the fire within bounds, for all the willing hands who came so swiftly, and for keeping us all safe. To you, O Lord, We commend our work, our dreams, our lives. In Jesus' precious name we pray.
Everyone joined him in the Amen.
Ufta! What a stench a fire can make.
Pa, you better come look. I think there's a body in that shed. Andrew's face appeared green behind the smoke stains. Chapter 1, May 1900.
Blessing.
I'm going home to Blessing. Home to Andrew.
Ellie, are you daydreaming again? I asked you to take this over to your pa.
Her mother, Goody Wold, peeked around the doorframe, a handled water jug in her hand.
Oofta, look at you. One would think you're pie-eyed or some such.
Pie-eyed?
Ellie turned from holding her graduation dress in front of her to see in the mirror. A lock of wavy golden hair lay over one shoulder. Concern wrinkled her wide forehead until she saw the teasing glint in her mother's eyes.
Pie-eyed?
You know, mooning over that young man of yours. Here we've been gone from Blessing for 2 years, and you ignored every suitor who has come to call. Now take that handsome Mr.
No. You take him, and send him elsewhere. Andrew Bjorklund is the only man for me, and he always has been.
She swung back and drew the waistline of the baby blue lawn dress against her slim middle, and with the other hand held the bodice to her chest.
This turned out well, don't you think?
Of course it did, you silly child. Everything you sew turns out beautiful.
Goody sat down on the edge of the four-poster, the lovingly turned posts, a tribute to Ellie's adoptive father, Olaf Wold, who made the most beautiful furniture west of the Mississippi. Right now he was working on a table and 6 chairs for Ellie and Andrew's wedding present.
Perhaps I should have made this in white and used the same dress both for graduation and my wedding. That would have been more practical.
Ah, Ellie, dear heart, you're always so practical. This is a good time for you to be at least a little bit impractical. Besides, I think we can afford a few extra yards of dress goods.
Ellie finished studying the dress and glanced at the smiling face above it. Dreamy might be a good word to apply to her. Her father said she looked like an angel, but she knew too well the streak of stubbornness that ran like double-strength whalebone up her spine. While some might say she was persistent, she knew it went beyond that. Bullheaded, more likely. Although she managed to cover it with sweet smiles and soft words. Andrew likened her hair to golden wheat flowing down her back, so for him she kept it long, although she'd been tempted to follow the new trends and cut it shorter when some of her friends did. Short hair on her forehead might cover the marks that remained from her bout of chickenpox as a small child. One thing bothered her. Her eyes. They were gray and slightly tipped up at the outer edges, and always reflected the color she wore. Toby Valders had once called her cat eyes when she was wearing a green dress. She shuddered at the memory. Andrew had nearly beaten him into the ground for that, and later promised her he would never fight again. Andrew, whom she hadn't seen since Christmas when the entire family took the train back to Blessing. Andrew, who'd been her protector since the day she was carried into the Bjorklund home, ill and half-starved. Her whole family would have died had it not been for Hjalmar Bjorklund, who had stopped by their soddy on his way home all those years ago. Andrew, whom she'd had to leave behind when Olaf decided to move his family out of the floodplain of the Red River Valley and settle in Grafton. Not that far away from Blessing, yet more than half a day's journey by buggy or horse. She'd be forever grateful that Reverend Soldberg said she could come home to graduate with her class, the friends she'd grown up with.
Tante Goody,
her young cousin, Rachel Anderson, said from the doorway.
Uncle Olaf says he needs you.
Rachel had come to stay with them the year before when her mother died. The little girl was the only member of the family to survive cholera.
Tell him I'll be right there.
Goody stood with a bit of a groan.
I will.
Rachel dashed off, never walking when she could run. Your knee still bothering you? Ellie asked as she hung her dress on a padded hanger, then on the bar in the clothes press.
Some, but mostly when I get up, falling like I did.
Goody shook her head.
Enough about me. When Rachel gets back, you two go get the mail, would you please?
She smiled at the delight bursting on Ellie's face.
I know. Most likely there's a letter from Andrew. But the rest of us get mail now and then, too. Poor Rachel. She's already feeling sad that you'll be leaving us.
More? I won't be gone long. Just a ways away. Besides, the wedding isn't until the end of June. We have to get our house built first. Soon after Rachel returned, they headed out to pick up the mail. Ellie swung her cousin's hand as they strolled the four blocks to the post office.
I don't want you to go away.
Rachel stared at Ellie from under the wide brim of her straw hat, the same hat Ellie had worn the year before. Today, Ellie wore a new straw hat, this one with a narrower brim and a more rigid crown. A pink rose centered the white ribbon with strings down the back.
Who will listen to me in the middle of the night when I have a bad dream?
Ellie smiled at her young cousin. At 10, Rachel looked more like a bundle of sticks walking than the lovely young woman she promised to become. She would rather fish and chase with the neighbor boys than worry about keeping her nose from freckling. But her silky eyelashes and curly hair were the envy of all the budding girls at the church. Rachel just didn't recognize such things yet.
You haven't had a bad dream in a long time. I think you're over them. But who will braid my hair so it doesn't fly all over the place?
Her pleading glance near to broke Ellie's heart.
Tanta don't braid.
Doesn't.
You know what I mean.
I know, but you have to speak properly. Otherwise, you sound slow and stupid.
I'll never be like you.
Oh, Rachel, you don't want to be like me. You want to be the best you that you can be. God made you special in his eyes, and he has a plan for you that only you can fill.
How come he doesn't tell me?
He often doesn't, just gives glimpses and peeks sometimes. But look at your feet. They both stopped and looked down. Now, step with your right foot. They both did.
Oh, Lord, how to explain this?
See, until you took one step, and then one with the other foot, you couldn't take the second with the first. Some things you just can't know ahead. They looked at each other, and Rachel shook her head.
I see what you mean.
She stepped one foot at a time again.
So, if I just keep walking, God will guide my footsteps?
He said so. But you have to read your Bible to hear his instructions. Rachel groaned.
I know you think it doesn't make sense sometimes, but some things are very clear. Every story in the Bible is there to teach us something. Like David and Goliath? I like that one.
Rachel made a whirling motion with her hand.
Three little pebbles from his sling, and bam! The giant fell.
So, what's the lesson in that story? They were nearly at the post office.
Learn to use a sling real good. I've been practicing, but don't get it yet.
Well, not good. Food tastes good. We do things well.
See? You go away, and who's going to teach me to speak proper?
You might listen in school instead of writing notes to Elspeth. She opened the door to the post office, and they both stepped inside.
Vold mail, please.
Ellie said to the man behind the counter. He turned to the rows of boxes and pulled out a packet, then handed it to her. As soon as she saw Andrew's handwriting on an envelope, Ellie wanted to find a quiet spot and read it, hugging all his words to herself, letting them soak in and join all the others she had stored away in her heart. Rachel groaned and rolled her eyes. "Andrew is a Budinsky." "What a thing to say!" Ellie tucked Andrew's letter into her pocket and sorted through the remainder of the mail to make sure nothing that didn't belong to them had made its way into their box. The day before, she'd had to bring back something belonging in the post office box next to theirs. The young woman putting out the mail was in love, and even if the whole town collapsed, she'd never notice. Pie-eyed for certain. "Good thing I'm not that way," she said to herself. "But does that mean I'm not really in love with Andrew?" The thought stopped her short. What if she'd loved him for so long that she was not in love, but in brotherly love, like the way Astrid loved her brother? Lord, do I know the difference? "Come on, let's hurry. I'm going over to play with Elspeth after we get home." "You go on ahead. I'll be along shortly." "Give me the rest of the mail, then, so you can go mooning over St. Andrew's letter." Ellie gave her the mail and a swat on the bottom. "Someday you'll be in love, and then I'll get even." She arched her eyebrows. "Why, Mr. Whatchamacallit, did you know that Rachel used to chew her fingernails and her braids, too? Why, I remember when..." Rachel hooted and took off up the street. "Ellie and Andrew sitting in a tree. K-I-S-S-I-N-G. Ellie shook her head. Why not let the whole world know their private business? She took the envelope from her pocket and stared at the handwriting. Andrew, so big and strong, yet gentle and kind. A warmth started in her middle and curled lazily up to set her heart to thudding. She had not been running, but she felt like she might have been. Surely one didn't feel this way about a brother. Surely this was love so true as to be ready for marriage. The length of their love only strengthened it. She sat down on one of the benches by the town park and carefully slit the drop of wax free from the paper. Andrew had drawn a small heart in the wax. She caught it in her skirt, picked it up, and slid it into the envelope. One more thing that Andrew had done especially for her. She unfolded the paper. "Ellie? Ellie?" Only Maydell would call like that from half a block away. Ellie sighed and tucked her letter into her reticule. She watched her best friend in Grafton come dancing across the grass, holding her hat with one hand and, of all things, a fan in the other. Now what scheme was she concocting to attract poor Mr. Farnsworth, the new choir director at their church? In a pink dress matching her cheeks made more pink by the run, Maydell was as short and round as Ellie was tall and slender. They were matched in determination. "I was afraid I wouldn't see you before you left." Maydell sank down on the bench beside Ellie and unfurled her fan to cool her face. "When did you start carrying a fan?" "Well, I've been reading about how to attract a man by use of a fan." She fluttered it close to her face, her dark eyes dancing above the beribboned fan edge. "Doesn't this make me look more mysterious? Men like mystery in a woman, you know." Ellie shook her head. "No, I wouldn't know." "But you should learn. Perhaps teach Andrew a thing or two. Make him wild for you." "Maydell, what have you been reading?" The thought of some of the things Andrew had said in his letters unfurled the warmth in her middle again. "About romance, silly. Remember reading Romeo and Juliet? How Romeo called beneath her window? Now that is romance." "But they both died, remember?" "And Juliet is the sun." Maydell fluttered her fan and gave a good imitation of pie-eyed. "Here." She snapped the fan shut and pulled the string from her wrist, then thrust it at Ellie. Now you try it, so I can see what it looks like. Although I have to admit, I've spent time in front of the mirror practicing. Oh. Ellie took the fan, and when trying to open it, dropped it in her skirt. She looked at her friend, and they both chuckled. Maydell repositioned Ellie's fingers and showed her how to spread the fan wide, then hold it open using her thumb against her fingers. She fluttered it close to her face and stared deep into Maydell's eyes. This way she could hide the twitch of her lips behind the fan. Her voice deepened and grew husky.
Ah, my dear, you are so ravishing.
Maydell clutched her clasped hands to her throat. Oh, yes! Ellie snapped the fan closed. Yes? What kind of answer is that? Someone says you are ravishing and you say yes? What happened to thank you or tell me more? She shook her head again. I don't need a fan when I go see Andrew. I need extra aprons because we're going to be building our house and barn. That is, if the house arrives anytime soon. Well, if you're sure. Maydell stood and raised her attention to the rustling leaves of the elm tree above them, trying for a dramatic pose. I'm sure. At least, I think I'm sure. This was love, she felt, the kind of love she saw between her ma and pa. I hope graduation exercises go well for you. Mr. Farnsworth will be playing the organ. Try to pay attention to the ceremony. I wouldn't want you fainting or something. But then, you'll have your fan, right? Maydell leaned over and gave her a hug. I'll see you again before the wedding. Yes, I'll be back to get my things. You could take extra hankies to drop. Go practice your fan. Ellie shooed her away, laughing at the pout Maydell half hid behind the fan. Very good. That one should get him. As soon as her friend was on her way home, Ellie took out the letter again, unfolded the page, and began to read. May 13th, 1900. Dearest Ellie, her heart skipped a beat as she heard his voice in the reading. I am counting the days, nay, the hours, until I see you again. I am supposed to be writing my final essay, but I couldn't quit thinking of you, so I'm writing this instead. I will be like Torlif used to be, burning the midnight oil to finish my lessons. Only he went on to college, and in spite of Moore's encouragement, I do not plan to do that, as you know. She would like me to go to Grand Forks to the agricultural school, but I will learn all I need to learn about new farming ideas from the magazines, newspapers, and books that Torlif makes sure find their way into our house. Besides, we couldn't get married if I went off to college. The whole family is excited about Torlif and Elizabeth's baby coming soon. The women think men shouldn't discuss such happenings. But you know me. I think that is downright stupid. Having babies is as ordinary as cows having calves. Except that calves are cuter. Now don't go getting riled up. You know I'm only teasing you. She stared up at the branches over her head. Andrew did love to tease, but he was never malicious about it like Toby Valder's had been when they were in school together. Toby most likely would be at the graduation, but surely she was beyond letting him bother her any longer. Maybe he had changed. Leave it to Andrew to talk so easily about having babies. But then, he'd not been there when her mother nearly died in childbirth and the baby was born blue and wax-like. No matter that she'd been so young, she still remembered that day. The thought of suffering like her mother had for hours and hours had dug a hole down inside her and filled it brimful with fear, a ripping, tearing fear that infected her joy when she allowed herself to think on it. Something that was happening more often as the wedding date drew near. She returned to her letter, the sun having dimmed slightly, even though no cloud crossed the sky. Pastor Solberg said to send you his greetings and to say that he is happy you are coming back to graduate with the rest of us. I asked him if he would conduct our wedding, and he said he thought I'd never ask, and if someone else came to do that, he'd have to do battle with him. Isn't that typical of our Pastor Solberg? Astrid has written a letter, and I will include it with mine. Don't believe everything she says about the way I've been acting. Your loving Andrew. Ellie read the letter again and put it back into the envelope. Maybe seeing Andrew would allay her fears. But what if it didn't? Chapter 2. Easy, old girl. Just finish pushing that calf out so I can go back to bed. Andrew stood from his kneeling position beside the birthing cow.
Thought I'd find you out here.
Håkon leaned on the half wall of the calving stall, watching his younger son in action.
She needed some help, is all. She'd been laboring too long.
Andrew washed his hands and arm in the bucket of water now gone cool.
I went in and straightened that front leg. Now they're all right.
They watched as the calf slid out onto the straw, still encased in the birth sack, but for the two front hooves now parallel to each other. Andrew picked up some straw and began scrubbing the sack away, clearing the calf's muzzle. It shook its head at the intrusion and bleated, coughing out phlegm. While it lay still for a moment, gaining strength, the afterbirth followed, and the cow surged to her feet, then turned to begin licking her baby. She glared at Andrew and shook her head, warning him to stay back. She was now in charge.
This one's yours, you know.
Håkon rested on his crossed arms.
You don't need to do that. You already deeded me the land for my house and barn. I know, but your moor and I decided that the calf crop this year would belong half to you. What do you have there, a bull or a heifer?
Bull.
Oh, that won't help much with your milking herd. But he'll taste mighty good when he grows enough.
They usually castrated the bull calves and fed them out for beef, unless one was of particularly good breeding and build. Then they sold it for a breeding bull. Some of the farmers to the west would often write and ask if they had dairy bulls for sale. The Blessing Cheese Company Ingeborg had started was known coast to coast for its delicious cheese. While the Bjorklund name stood for farming success due to hard work and good management. 20 years earlier, two brothers with their families homesteaded on the banks of the Red River of Dakota Territory. The town of Blessing, located north of Grand Forks and northeast of Grafton, grew after the arrival of the train lines that crisscrossed the fertile Red River Valley, hauling wheat east to the flour mills of Minnesota and supplies west to the prairie farmers. Andrew shut the stall door behind him, satisfied now that the calf was nursing and the cow clearly wanting him to leave. Like his mother, Andrew had inherited the gift of healing, but most of his talents went to helping animals, not humans. People were Ingeborg's province, or they had been until her older son, Torlif, came home from college, bringing with him a budding newspaper career and a wife, Dr. Elizabeth Bjorklund. Father and son strolled back to the house. The star canopy arched above them. A thin sliver of moon hung in the west, with a bright star dangling off the lower point, as if caught like a fish. The breeze carried the fragrance of spring, burgeoning earth, newly turned and seeded, and grass growing so fast as to be measured daily on a yardstick. A few minutes later, when he slid back between the cool sheets, Andrew thought again of the letter he'd received from Ellie. Locking his arms behind his head, he let his mind play both backward and forward. Back to the last time he saw her at Christmas, and ahead to their wedding and a lifetime together. Ellie. His Ellie. ever since the sick little girl was carried into his mother's house in the dead of winter. Mr. Peterson had died, leaving his wife and two children to manage on their own. Andrew had never forgotten the look of her, all gray eyes, in a face so thin and tiny that it seemed you could see right through her. As she grew stronger, he'd appointed himself her guardian, and had never stopped. The family teased him when he'd stated that when they were big, he was going to marry up with Ellie. He'd never changed his mind, not even after Uncle Olaf decided to move his family to Grafton, farther away from the banks of the Red River and the horrible floodwaters of 1897. He had all of her letters of these past 2 years tied with a leather thong and in a box under his bed. When he needed a shot of Ellie's good common sense, he took them out and read them by kerosene lamplight. 3 more days until graduation, and then little more than a month till their wedding. If all went well, the planting would be done, and the grass not ready to hay. The week after graduation, they were having a house raising on his own land. He'd ordered the house package from Sears and Roebuck, and it should be arriving on the train any day now. He'd used his savings and borrowed from the farm to buy the house. He'd used the $100 each graduate received for future schooling to pay back more and far. "Soon, Ellie, my heart, soon." His whisper floated on the breeze, coming through the window, playing with the white lace curtains all newly washed and starched after his mother's annual spring cleaning. No dirt dared to reside in the Bjorklund home after the women scrubbed it inside and out. At least this year, there had been no flood to leave all the dirt behind. At school the next day, Andrew took his final exams. While he struggled with some of the arithmetic equations, and didn't have the writing skills of his brother Torlif, he knew he'd passed with reasonable grades. Perfection in the field, with straight rows and weeds afraid to even pop out of the soil, was necessary. Nay, obligatory. But the same rules did not apply in the classroom, at least not according to Andrew. For his younger sister Astrid, that was a different matter. She upheld the tradition that Torlif started of all straight A's and threw extra in for good measure. Andrew handed in his final exam. "Thank you. You may be excused." Reverend Sulberg laid the papers on a growing pile. "You mean I'm done for the day?" Andrew kept his voice to a whisper so he wouldn't disturb those still writing.
"That's what I mean, but I expect you back tomorrow morning to help with the cleaning of the building. Must have a clean school for graduation."
"Everyone will be cleaning?"
"Some will be finishing their tests. I thought you seniors could start on the outside, cutting the grass around both the school and the church, washing the windows, those kinds of things. Bring cleaning supplies."
Reverend Sulberg smoothed his thinning hair back with one hand. He sometimes said he was not only turning gray, but was losing hair over the antics of some of his students. Andrew clapped his hat on his head as soon as he exited the school and leapt the 2 steps to the ground. He felt like yelling, "I'm done!" loud enough to scare the birds and reach the heavens. But that was surely the antics of a child, and he no longer considered himself a child. Hadn't, in fact, for several years. Ever since Torlif left home to go to St. Olaf College in Northfield, Minnesota, Andrew had been the oldest of the children at home, and he had long done the work of a man, milking cows, doing field work, helping in the cheese house, whatever needed to be done. He'd rather work outside than study any day of the week. He stuffed his hands into his pockets and set off for the general store owned by his Tante Penny, whistling as he went. Perhaps his house had come in on the train, although you'd have thought they'd come ask him to help unload it. Buying the Sears and Roebuck house package so that his and Ellie's house would go up more quickly had seemed a stroke of genius on his part. No longer were there enough trees available to cut their own logs for a sawmill that Håkon used to run. He needed to buy the lumber for his barn, too. Had he been wise in starting with the house? They could have raised a soddy, but the thought of taking his new wife into a soddy made him shake his head. He'd thought long and hard on it. Ellie needed sunlight like a sunflower did, not the dank darkness of a soddy. At least the ground had dried enough that the gumbo no longer weighted down his boots. He kicked off any dirt on the store steps and scraped his soles over a scraper by the door. Tapping on the window, he caught Tanta Penny's attention as she rearranged the window display.
"How come you're not in school?" she called back.
"Finished." He pushed open the door, setting the bell above to jangling.
"That looks right nice."
His compliment made her smile widen.
"Andrew, you always say the nicest things."
Penny climbed over the small picket fence made to protect her window display and gave him a hug.
"I can't believe you are really graduating so soon. I close my eyes and you're still a little guy, dragging after Torlif, or down playing with whatever animal babies there were."
She stared up into his eyes. Bjorklund blue eyes, they were called.
"You and Paws."
She sniffed and locked her arm through his.
"Here I go, getting all weepy. It's not like you're moving away or anything."
"Just from one house to another."
He squeezed her hand against his side.
"You have any mail for me to take on home? And did my house come?" "Sorry, no house.
But do you think that dear Ellie would let more than a couple of days go by before writing to you?" She went behind the counter to the wall of cubbyholes and pulled out a newspaper and several pieces of mail.
"I'll bet half of these are cheese orders."
She held one envelope back.
"Except for this."
"What am I offered?" Andrew shook his head.
"I have to pay for my own mail?"
He scrunched up his eyes.
"What would it take?"
He opened his eyes and shook his head.
"Please don't say you need wood chopped."
"Now that you've volunteered,"
she laughed and handed him the letter.
"I'd be truly grateful if you'd fill the wood box for me. I'm baking something special for Hjalmar, so that he remembers how good things are at home."
His uncle Hjalmar, youngest of the Norwegian-born Bjorklund brothers, had been elected to the State Assembly and now spent more time on the road than he did at his blacksmith and machinery sales business. Old Sam took care of the one, and Mr. Valders the other, as well as being the bank manager when needed.
"I will."
He folded the letter carefully and put it in his breast pocket, right over his heart, where he usually carried Ellie's latest letter. Never would he have dreamed that he could be such a faithful correspondent.
"So, when are the Wolds coming?"
Penny asked.
"Tomorrow."
"They're going to stay at the boarding house?"
His grandma Bridget ran the boarding house just up the street.
"I doubt it. Moore offered them a room upstairs."
He headed out back to bring in wood. Instead of being stacked neatly against the woodshed, it was tossed in a pile, and there was not much of it. Should he split some now or come back later? Like as Moore had said more than once, it was great having Uncle Hjalmar helping run North Dakota, but when his family needed him, he wasn't often around. Like now, to chop wood. Andrew took off his shirt and hung it on the clothesline so he could be free to chop. He set a butt up on the block and brought the axe down right in the middle. When it took a second swing, he shook his head. The axe needed sharpening. His pa had been a lumberjack before coming west to help his relatives, and had drilled into his sons the necessity of a sharp axe. Keeping one's axe sharp was a good metaphor for life, one that Andrew understood clear to his heart. He took the axe over to the blacksmith shop and sat down at the stone wheel to grind an edge on it again. Håkon always set a good example, taking care of his tools and machinery, fixing anything that came loose or cracked or showed wear. Sparks peppered Andrew's bare chest as he pedaled the wheel and held the axe bit against it until the edge was sharp enough to shave with. Or at least that was the joke. Since he'd only had to shave a couple of times in his whole life, he didn't want to try doing so with the axe bit. Back at the woodpile, he split enough to last a couple of days and loaded his sweaty arm high. It took him 4 trips to fill the wood box.
"Leave it to you, Andrew, to go far beyond what I asked for."
Penny handed him a napkin filled with cookies.
"So you don't starve on the way home."
She reached up and kissed his cheek.
"I don't know what I would do without you."
"I don't think you have to worry about me going anywhere."
He shrugged into his shirt. "Me and Ellie will be right here. See you later." He waved and headed for the door, only to have it pushed open before he reached for the handle. Stepping back, he groaned inside.
"Well, well, if it ain't Prince Andrew."
Toby Valders took a step back and gave a half bow.
"That's enough, Valders."
Andrew kept a smile on his face with sheer effort. Why did Toby always have to say something that set Andrew's teeth on edge?
"A bit surly today. Has not the fair Ellie arrived yet?"
Toby's dark eyes narrowed slightly. While Toby had never gained the height of the Bjorklund boys, he had filled out in the chest and shoulders since he left school. Hard work had a tendency to do that. The dark hair and swarthy looks of both Gerald and Toby stood out in this land of blonde Norwegians. Andrew ignored the barb.
"How's Gerald?"
Toby's older brother had returned from the Spanish-American War in ill health, although he'd not been wounded. Toby shrugged.
"Malaria comes and goes. He's helping Pa out, getting the bank and post office building ready."
The new building was across the street from Bridget's boarding house.
"I heard the sheriff came to see about that body burned in the fire."
Andrew shook his head.
"I was in school." "Yeah, that's right, still one of the kids."
Toby pushed on by to go into the store, his mocking laugh floating back behind. Andrew gritted his teeth. But if this was the worst Toby had to dish out, he'd not have a problem keeping his promise to Ellie. Once again, he waved to Penny and headed back to the schoolhouse to harness up the wagon. His cousin Trygve would be in charge of the wagon next year. Hard to believe that Trygve would be the oldest Bjorklund boy in the school next year. Not that Astrid, Sophie, or Grace couldn't harness the horse and drive the wagon, but the task had always fallen to the boys. Astrid leaped off the steps, as did most of the other students, and within minutes, Andrew had a wagon full of laughing and shouting children. Reverend Solberg waved them away.
"Remember, tomorrow we clean, so bring soap, buckets, and rags."
"No more homework, no more books, no more teachers' dirty looks."
Sophie led the chant and had them all laughing.
Tomorrow he'd see Ellie again.
Andrew clapped his hand over his pocket. He'd forgotten to read her letter. Chapter 3.
"Dear Ingeborg, thank you for the invitation to come to Andrew's graduation. I do wish we could attend, but spring came late here, and Kane is just now seeding the wheat. He feels he cannot take any days off, and while he said we should go ahead without him, I would rather wait and come after the harvest. I know I will miss the celebration, but I hate to leave him. It seems I always do that. How I would love to see Moore more often. I wrote to her also. I know she will be as disappointed in not seeing her 3 grandchildren. They are disappointed too. They were so looking forward to playing with their cousins. Forgive me for not being a better correspondent, and I will try to write more often. Give my love to all my family in blessing. I wish you could all come down here.
We have plenty of room on the ranch, and Kane says he'll even round up some horses for the boys to ride. After they break them, of course. Better close and get to making supper. Yours affectionately, Augusta Bjorklund Moyer.
Ingeborg sighed and refolded the letter. Having the entire family here would have been nice for a change. Doesn't Augusta understand her mother is getting up in years? After the last spell that Bridget had, Ingeborg had come to the realization that her mother-in-law might not live forever, in spite of her protestations to the otherwise. Bridget did not appreciate any advice suggesting she slow down. When guests came to her boarding house, they expected good food, a clean bed, and a cheerful time. She was known far beyond the outskirts of Blessing, since Henry Osgard, her husband of nearly 10 years, had been a railroad man. He always said it was her cooking that caught his attention and her smile that caught his heart. Ingeborg's knees creaked when she stood up. She shook her head. Her coronet of braids was not as bright as when she was younger, but was still thick, and her husband's delight. Especially when, sitting on the edge of their bed, she let the braids down and brushed her requisite 100 strokes a night. Something nagged at her.
Oof-ta, I'm getting to be an old woman, forgetting things, creaking when I walk. What was it I said I'd do?
Lines deepened on her forehead and between her eyebrows. She pulled the coffee pot to the hotter part of the stove. Perhaps a cup of coffee would revive her memory. She checked the bread baking in the oven, not quite brown enough, and glanced over at the pies waiting to be put in the oven. She'd used the last of the dried apples, and the 2 pie shells would be used for chocolate cream, Andrew's favorite. While everyone in Blessing would share the dinner after the graduation ceremony, she wanted some left here for their personal celebration. Barney barked a welcome, the tone saying it was someone he knew. Ingeborg changed her apron and went to the door.
Elizabeth, what a wonderful surprise.
Her daughter-in-law smiled and waved, then stepped carefully down from the buggy. While she'd said the baby wasn't due for another month, her girth said otherwise. But in the family way or not, Dr. Elizabeth Bjorklund had not slacked on her medical practice one bit.
I was hoping you had the coffee on. I'm in dire need of your outhouse, and then sustenance.
She tied her horse's lead rope to the hitching rail in front of the white picket fence that surrounded the white 2-story farmhouse.
The Svensson baby came with no trouble, a boy big enough to start crawling next week. That woman's pelvis must be made of elastic, the way she has such big babies so easily. I'll pour your coffee. Will a sandwich be enough, or should I warm some soup up, too? Yes, to all the above. Oof-ta.
Elizabeth smiled at adopting one of Ingeborg's Norwegian expressions. She massaged her lower back as she made her way around the house and followed the well-worn path to the privy. She'll not go another month, Ingeborg thought as she turned back into the house. Doctor or not, she will have that baby when it's ready to come. She smiled to herself. While she was still called to assist some births, Dr. Elizabeth did most of them nowadays. The people of Blessing and the surrounding area felt great relief at having a board-certified doctor in their midst, taking much of the pressure off Ingeborg, who'd used her gifts of healing for anyone who called her. Her doctoring began when she and her first husband, Roald Bjorklund, staked out their homestead near the confluence of the Red and Little Salt Rivers in the spring of 1880. Ingeborg went out to the well house, where they kept things cool, and brought in the kettle of soup she'd made the day before. Since it was time to begin dinner anyway, she'd have a bit of a jump on the preparations. Soup, along with bread right out of the oven, dinner fit for a king. Or a queen, as in this case. She shaded her eyes to see Håkon and his team out plowing the acreage he'd been seeding in oats for cattle feed. He and Lars worked in tandem, one team plowing just behind the other, both with double-bottom plows and four up. When the sun stood straight up, they'd head for the house, both eating here, because Karin's school for the deaf was still in session. Both schools would be out tomorrow afternoon. Most of the deaf students would be picked up or put on the train to go home on Saturday morning. Ingeborg added more wood to the firebox and gave the soup kettle a good stir so the vegetables wouldn't burn on the bottom. Taking two eggs from the basket on the table, she whisked them into a froth and, after measuring it in the palm of her hand, dumped salt into the eggs and beat in flour till she had a dry dough that she could drizzle into the soup to make spätzle, tiny dumplings that looked like fat strings. Elizabeth washed her hands at the bench outside and entered the kitchen.
Much better. Oh, it smells so good in here. Ingeborg, you bake the best bread. No matter how hard I try, mine just doesn't measure up. Thank you. I'll have those loaves out in a minute or two, and you can take one home with you.
She gave the soup another stir.
Sit down. Rest yourself in that rocking chair.
She glanced down at Elizabeth's feet.
Those boots look a mite tight. Better get your feet up, too.
I know. My feet started to swell last week when the warm weather hit.
I can't take long here.
I'm sure I have folks lined up at the office.
Yes, for starters.
Ingeborg handed Elizabeth a cup of coffee with a cookie on the saucer.
How's Thelma working out there?
She smiled as she remembered the woman who had arrived on the train one day looking for a job.
She's a godsend.
Elizabeth laid her head against the chair back.
What with Torlif gone again, I don't know what I'd do without her. He'll be back for the graduation.
He was going to be the speaker at the service, so she knew he would be.
Of course, he said he'd be back on the train tomorrow.
Elizabeth closed her eyes with a gentle sigh.
Guess I never realized how carrying a baby would make me feel so tired. You might want to cut back on taking care of other folks and look to taking care of you.
Ingeborg opened the oven door, and the fragrance of baking bread filled the room. She inhaled deeply and heard Elizabeth do the same. Don't you go giving advice where it may not be wanted, she reminded herself. She's the doctor, not you.
Ah, but she is carrying my first grandchild, and surely that gives me some kind of reason for my concern.
Now you sound just like my mother. Elizabeth opened her eyes and smiled. And yes, I know I should, especially after we lost the first one. But that was so early in the pregnancy that the baby hardly seemed real. She rocked gently.
But I've so often wondered, was it a boy or a girl? And did I do something to make it happen? I still think about the baby I lost so many years ago.
Ingeborg paused in turning the loaves out of the pans and onto a wooden rack so they could air.
And when I had no more after Astrid, for a while I wondered if God was punishing me for my willfulness.
And what did you decide?
What I read in the Old Testament was about a vengeful God. But in the New Testament, Jesus said his Father is love, and that whoever has seen him has seen the Father. I reread all the Gospels, and the only people Jesus spoke harshly to were the Pharisees, for their hard hearts. Everyone else he loved and healed. I reminded myself of those verses over and over. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Love one another as I have loved you. That's running them together, but I chose to believe them all. And I did what the Psalms and Paul said. I ate those words. I meditated on them day and night. I had no choice,
and it seemed that thinking on the word in the hours at night when I could not sleep was better than pacing and fretting. Another good verse, a simple one. Fret not. You are such a good example for me. It is easy to think all my training heals people, but I know that I just do what I can and God does the healing. Elizabeth smiled her thanks for the buttered heel of a warm loaf of bread.
You spoil me.
My privilege. Just think, now I have two daughters and will soon have a third.
She stirred the soup again. The spetzel were cooked enough, so she pushed the kettle to the cooler part of the stove to let it simmer.
She patted Elizabeth's shoulder and stepped outside to beat the iron bar around the insides of the iron triangle hanging by the back door. By the time the men arrived from the field, she would have the table set and the bread sliced.
Dishing up a bowl of soup for Elizabeth, she set it on a plate and put the plate in her daughter's lap.
There, now take your time.
Do you think you can spare Astrid to help me part of the time? Even with Thelma helping, there is plenty to do, and Astrid has such an aptitude for caring for the sick. I'm hoping she will choose to go for a nursing degree, or even study to be a doctor.
Of course, although she usually helps Penny with her little ones, and at the store in the summer.
That Penny. Now there is a Wonder Woman. How she manages the store, Yelmer's businesses, her family, and all her church things, I'll never know.
Elizabeth wiped her mouth on a napkin.
This soup is really good. Our cook at home made spätzle like this.
It's easy. We like dumplings of all kinds.
The dog's barking announced that the men were nearing the barn.
I better be on my way.
Elizabeth stood and set her dishes in the enameled dishpan sitting near the reservoir.
Mange tak for the refreshment.
Ingeborg wrapped a loaf of bread in a clean towel.
Here.
She added a wedge of cheese cut from a larger wedge sitting under a glass dome.
Try this sharp cheddar and tell me what you think. Now with the cows on grass again, we'll be making plenty more cheese.
They tried to sell out their supply of cheese each year before the possibility of spring flooding, so that none would go to waste. Orders came for Bjorklund cheese from as far away as St. Louis and Seattle. They'd even had orders from New York after she sent their benefactor, David Jonathan Gould, a small, well-waxed wheel one Christmas. Since Uncle Olaf now made cheese presses of various sizes, they produced more variety. She'd thought of adding Swiss cheese this year and ordered the culture to begin experimenting with. Her gammelost was a permanent success with all the Norwegians, including the new wave of immigrants. She hugged Elizabeth and walked with her out to the buggy, where her horse dozed in the sun.
I'll see you for supper on Saturday, then, if not before.
Yes. Elizabeth gave a discreet oof as she settled onto the seat.
If Mrs. Geddick has that baby any time soon, shall I send them over here?
Gladly.
She smiled up at the doctor.
You need to sleep through the night, and babies seem to want to come in the early morning hours. I think it's so their entrance can cause a stir.
That they do. Elizabeth rolled her eyes.
Will you please untie that lead rope for me?
How I manage to forget that little chore so often is beyond me.
We were talking, that's why.
Hey, Doc, what's your hurry?
Håkon called from where they were unharnessing the horses in front of the barn.
Got people waiting for me.
She waved and turned the rig around to jog down the lane. Ingeborg watched her go. If she knew anything about babies, this one for sure wasn't going to wait a whole month, no matter what the good doctor thought.
Perhaps she'd be delivering more than the Geddick baby.
The men had just finished eating when Barney announced a stranger arriving. Håkon set down his cup.
I wonder who that can be.
Wiping her hands on her apron, Ingeborg went to the screen door.
Can I help you?
The man dismounted from his horse, flipped the reins over the hitching rail, and pushed open the gate of the picket fence.
Mrs. Bjorklund.
Yes?
I'm Sheriff Becker from Grafton. I'm here to see your husband, if possible.
Of course. Come on in. Have you had dinner yet? We're just finishing.
She held the door open for him. He removed his fedora as he came through the doorway.
I think we've met before at some of the county meetings.
He nodded to the men at the table.
Håkon, Lars, I was hoping to find you where we could talk a bit.
Sit down, Astrid. Bring the man a plate.
I hate to put you out this way.
Have you eaten?
No.
Then take that chair.
While the men spoke, Ingeborg dished up some soup from the kettle on the stove, and Astrid filled a coffee cup and set it and the silverware in place.
So, Charles, what brings you clear over here? That body you found after the Olsen's shed burned. You know anything more about that?
No, since we've not heard of anyone missing. I think it was some bum off the train who holed up in there, and maybe it was him smoking that started the fire. We buried him over to the church plot. Didn't know what else to do. Was there any kind of identification on him?
Charles took a spoonful of the soup.
This is mighty good, Mrs. Bjorklund. Thank you. Nothing remained from the fire. He was burned near to a cinder.
Lars dunked his cookie in his coffee.
No one had seen a stranger around these parts? Nobody said they had. You know, the people here would come right out and say so if they knew something. We all just responded to the church bell tolling. Olsen's place is right near the church.
So, you don't think there was any foul play?
In Blessing?
Well, you never know, and it's my job to look into things like that.
He sopped the soup up with the last of his bread.
I have plenty more, Ingeborg offered.
Thanks, but that was enough. I'm going over to the Olsens next. Anyone hears anything, you'll let me know?
The sheriff nodded to Ingeborg.
Mighty fine, ma'am. Thank you.
He shoved his chair back.
Torlif was planning to put something about it in the paper. Perhaps that might bring out some information.
Håkon stood up.
Come again sometime when you can stay longer.
Ingeborg watched the men file out the door. Someone, somewhere, was missing a family member. How tragic. By the time they blew out the kitchen lamp, the sheriff's visit had been discussed soundly. Later, when Ingeborg and Håkon retired to their room, he lay against propped-up pillows, his hands locked behind his head, watching his wife brush her hair.
I've been thinking.
She turned to look at him. Even after all these years of marriage, the sight of his muscled chest and shoulders made her heart trip over its own beat. The silver in his hair caught the lamplight, silver that was getting more pronounced, as were the lines in his face. More scalp showed, giving his already broad forehead more skin, and a distinct line divided his tan face and the white of his hat-hidden head.
Thinking what?
You know Andrew's house is not coming on time.
Yeah.
She kept up her strokes, no longer needing to count, but doing so anyway, content with the rhythm.
Perhaps they should put off the wedding. Wait until we get the house and barn both up and the harvest in.
They are so young. But I sure don't want to be the one to suggest this to Andrew.
Ingeborg shook her head slowly.
Guess we should pray about it first. If you believe this is what's best, we need God to give you the right words
and Andrew to have willing ears to hear it. He thinks he's a man now, you know?
It isn't like we're saying to wait forever. Only 2-3 months or so. They have their whole lives ahead of them.
Ingeborg set her brush on the washstand and brought her hair over one shoulder to braid it loosely for the night.
Leave it down.
His request tickled the hairs on the back of her neck. She knew what he was asking, and yet the thought made her sigh. She should be glad he still cared for her in that way. When had she first yearned to put off her husband's advances? Most likely at the same time she stepped into being contrary. She wished she'd trapped that loud sigh before she blew out the lamp and crawled into bed. Sometimes loving him more than herself took extra effort. Later, when he'd turned over and his breathing deepened into sleep, she lay there watching the moonlight paint designs on the floor. You should be grateful, a small voice nagged. Should be grateful and were grateful were two different things, and never more obvious than right now. What would Andrew say when his far asked him to put off the wedding?
Oofda, she muttered to herself.
She had meant to bring up the subject of leaving more fields for pasture and hay, but she'd forgotten. Or did she just not want to get into another argument? It seemed they'd been gnawing at this bone of contention for years instead of only months. Chapter 4.
You want me to what?
Andrew stood with his mouth agape. Håkon raised a hand.
Now take it easy, let's talk about...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.